Hello, hello.
Just before we came in, Ron told me he wanted to enter like Ryan Seacrest down a flight of stairs. He was disappointed. Why is there no flight of stairs? Okay, all right. Enough with the stairs. Okay, all right.
Okay, so just a quick introduction. My name is Clay Cadis. I'm an animator at Disney. I've been there for 17 years. You may know me from the Animation Podcast. It was in 2005 when I interviewed these guys, and it's a long time ago now. I think today's going to be pretty easy, because if you've heard that interview, I just kind of ask one question and they'll talk for 20 minutes. So this is going to be really great. But time's getting short, so we'll cut the introduction. But I will say, though, you know, these guys have directed together just 6 films: Great Mouse Detective, Little Mermaid, stop me if I'm wrong here, Aladdin, Hercules, Treasure Planet, and Princess and the Frog. And I looked it up online, and they've made about... combined about $1.4 billion worldwide, so that's not too shabby. So that's not the point of being here, though. So let's... and again, about the podcast, you know, we talked a lot about their career and how they got to where they are. So I don't really want to cover that again. So what I've asked these guys to do is bring a lot of materials that maybe people haven't seen before, and we'll just kind of... it'll be the visual companion to the interview that I did before. So let's just dive into this. Okay. John Musker.
Thank you. I'm John Musker, for those of you who don't know me. And this is?
Ron Clements. And, Ron. People, when they meet us, they have a 50-50 chance of getting it right. And it's amazing how often that
actually,
they
I just saw Mike Enns yesterday, and he called me Ron. Mike, are you here? No, that's okay. Okay. Okay, all right.
So let's just jump back to the beginning of how you guys got to Disney. And Ron, you were in 1974, right?
74, January of 1974. I started a little before John. I was part of a little period before John. John was part of the CalArts period, and he will talk about that. I'm part of, I guess, the pre-CalArts period, which actually started, I think, Disney was kind of a closed shop for years and years and years. It was pretty much impossible to get in. And then when Walt died, and I always forget the year, 66. I always think 67. It was the same time the movie The Jungle Book came out, and The Jungle Book was a huge success. So Disney had considered that they might just kind of let animation go away after Walt died. But after Jungle Book made so much money, they decided to keep it going, and they decided to start recruiting new people, which they had not done for years. And they started this talent development program, which I was a part of. So January 1974, I had submitted my portfolio and a film that I made. And I talked about it before, but the way it worked was kind of like you had 4 weeks to do sort of a screen test. And if you passed the screen test, you would go another 4 weeks. The review board sort of looked at your work and then decided if you had potential or not. If you made it through the 8 weeks, you were put on permanent salary. I think I have a slide here.
Well, it's up.
This is kind of probably the first picture I have from that period. This is probably the first year that I was at the studio. I'm the guy without the beard. It's one of the very few pictures of me. I'm on the far left side.
In his wild and crazy guy shirt there.
Yeah, well, the fashion is going to be tremendous here. So this was kind of a group that was there when I went. This is probably pre-Glenn Keane, and Glenn Keane came probably just about 4 or 5 months after me, but I don't think he was there when this picture was taken. Right in front of me is, with the drink in his hand, is Andy Gaskell. He was a great animator, art director. He was the art director on Lion King and our films Hercules and Treasure Planet. Tad Stones, Gary Goldman, behind Gary Goldman is Al Huck, then Dick Sebast, a really good story guy. Mike McKinney, who Chuck Harvey is covering up with his hand that he's waving, Chuck Harvey in the beret. Heidi Goodell, and Dale Baer is back there in the far right. At this point, Dale Baer was the only one in this group who was a bona fide animator. He had been made an animator during Robin Hood. And Don Bluth, who's not in this picture, was also an animator. Everybody else were kind of aspiring animators. And we were working on Winnie the Pooh and Tigger 2. That was the third Winnie the Pooh feature. And we were in what is called the penthouse at the studio. It was kind of on the top floor where they had parties and things. And I think this was a party for Milt Kahl. And right behind, there's pictures of Milt, younger Milt, older Milt, and a baby Milt, I guess.
Milk.
I guess there's, yeah, we're so anyway.
Milt Paul is trying to work his way through all of you.
That's kind of where I started. I guess the next picture, I worked with Frank Thomas on The Rescuers. He was my mentor, and then a little bit on Fox and the Hound. I did some stuff on Pete's Dragon in between that, and it was a great, great period working with Frank. I was on The Rescuers. I started as an animation trainee working with Frank, and I became an animator on The Rescuers. And once again, my fashion sense was pretty spectacular.
Of course, yeah. He wore a lot of Western shirts then. And Joe Hale, the producer of Black Cauldron, around this time then when Star Wars came out, he took to calling Ron Chewy in an affectionate way.
My nickname was Chewbacca. But speaking of Star Wars, around the time Rescuers came out, I think Rescuers came out the same year as Star Wars. But Star Wars had a huge impact on all of us there. We were a group in our 20s, and I was 20 when I started at Disney, and almost everybody in our group, with a few exceptions, were in their 20s. And Star Wars just kind of blew everyone away. And and even George Lucas said, it's a Disney film. That's what he was trying to do. And we were thinking, why can't we do films like that? But
I have to add just with this photo, when we put this whole presentation together, Ron brought this photo, the physical photo, to me. And I was just like, I'm holding the picture that's in the Illusion of Life. It's very, very cool.
Around this time, Los Angeles Magazine did an article about the new group of Disney animators. Sort of, there was the nine old men, and then there was the new group. And this is a picture of that new group. And now, in this case, this is a few years later. I think maybe toward the tail end of before The Rescuers was released. But while we were all working on Fox and the Hound, and there are pictures from that Mel Shaw had done early things for the Black Cauldron that are in the background there. But that was kind of this pre-CalArts group of animators. There again, there's Gary Goldman. There's Glenn Keane leaning back on the chair. Glenn was the only one who went to CalArts, but he wasn't part of the CalArts character animation program. He went to CalArts before they had that program. He was in Jules Engel's class. It was a sort of different kind of program. Then there's me, or there's Andy sort of leaning down. Then there's me, Ed Gombert, who's a great storyman, Randy Cartwright, an animator, and Ed was at that time John Pomeroy, and Don Bluth. And we all look very, very happy in this picture. It's very happy. But even when this picture was taken, there was a little bit of tension going on among probably the sort of the Don Bluth group and the little bit the sort of non-Don Bluth group. And that tension would sort of simmer for a while, I think.
And then explode. Yeah. So let's just go to the
next.
Yeah, do you want to intro this, or?
This is kind of silly and stupid, but if you want to see something that you've never seen before, when The Rescuers came out, I'm from Sioux City, Iowa, originally, which is a fairly small city, and so it was kind of, there was sort of excitement that I was an animator on The Rescuers. I actually worked on a movie, and when I went back to my hometown, they wanted to do something, although I missed the theatrical because the films only ran for a week or so, and actually when I went back, it wasn't running in a theater anymore. It was at the drive-in. So they asked me to do something at the drive-in.
They would bring you popcorn and do drawings for you.
Actually, there was an ad in the newspaper that day. When I got up that morning, I saw an ad in the newspaper that said, "Tonight, in person, Ron Clements, watch him make animated characters come to life before your very eyes." I thought, what am I going to do? But I did sort of a demonstration. I drew some characters. That's me again.
This is all the setup, and then this is the punchline, I think, right here.
It was pretty big deal. So that's my story.
All right, let's jump ahead to John.
So yes, I followed a slightly different path. Some of you have seen this picture before, and some of you are in this picture. This is CalArts. I went to CalArts in the mid-70s. But so in this picture, that is me in the lower right, Steve Allen glasses, Elvis Costello glasses.
It's also kind of a Where's Waldo.
This is during my Where's Waldo period, which has continued even to the present day pretty much. Two people above me hovering over there is Nancy Beeman, who's seated in the front row here, teacher at Sheridan College. Yes. And Nancy is grabbing Brad Bird, is that guy right there. He was in our class. Brad is not here. I think he's on his way to Dubai, where they're going to have the world premiere of Mission Impossible 4, which Brad has directed, and very cool. And so that is also the guy hovering on the upper left up there. That is John Lasseter, who is in our class.
Way in the back.
Way in the back with the kind of Bela Lugosi
thing.
Pencil in his teeth. Yes, that's John. And that's Elmer Plummer in the middle. And there are a few other people in this picture. Bruce Morris is giving a panel even as we speak.
Doug Leffler.
And Doug Leffler is also in
part of that panel.
Yes, so many people in this picture, join the industry, and we're all, friends to this day. It's great. I did win that year from that teacher, Elmer Plummer, in the middle. I won the first, and I think people have only given it once or twice, the Elmer Award. So here's a wonderful picture of, there we are, yes. there I am, winning the Elmer Award, yes. It was a $25 savings bond, I'll have you know. And I'm still hoping to cash that. I think it's worth about $19 now, and it's accruing every year. It's going to get to $25. That is Jack Hanna, too, on the right side of the picture, who is in charge of the program. Not Hanna of Hanna-Barbera, but Jack Hanna, who directed a lot of the Chip and Dale shorts and the Donald Duck shorts. And he ran the program at CalArts. And Elmer was the life drawing teacher. And Elmer was a great artist at Disney. He storyboarded the mushroom sequence in Fantasia, and he did the roustabout sequence in Dumbo. Great watercolor.
He also taught classes at the studio.
He did as well.
We had evening classes at the studio in our group, and a lot of these guys who taught at CalArts, like Elmer Plummer and Teehee, Ward Kimball, also, I don't know if Ward Kimball was there, but they taught evening classes at the studio.
Yeah.
So it was great. And we actually got to actual diplomas from each class that we graduated. So I have a diploma that I graduated from Elmer, Blaine Gibson, Ward Kimball, and Teehee's class.
Okay, that's cool. Some of which Teehee taught at CalArts. But the teacher really, or the guy that taught us animation, really the mentor of the program there, and this is a caricature. This sort of a presentation is sprinkled with caricatures I've done over the years of these people. But did I do that right, Clay?
I think so.
He's really not that wide. Eric Larson, who was one of the nine old men. Great, wonderful teacher from Utah originally. Worked on Lady and the Tramp. He did Peg in that, and he did Figaro the Cat in Pinocchio.
The Owl and Bambi.
And he was great with animals.
He was the head of the training program at the studio.
He was. So everybody that came through in the mid-70s kind of went through under Eric's wing, and he was really a wonderful avuncular teacher, very... giving, and really it was great. He literally would put a sheet of paper down over your drawings and show you how you could make a stronger pose or communicate better or just the timing, and he's really the person that I learned animation from. I have one more drawing of Eric. Again, it'll look too wide here. It's probably too late to adjust the format.
Yeah,
right? But yes, there's me and Eric back in the day.
So you were an intern in 76.
I was an intern in 76. I went to CalArts. I was starting CalArts in September of 75, along with Nancy. And I was there for 2 years. Nancy and John Lasseter were there for four. I think they were the first ones to get a full four-year diploma from the school. But in between my 2 years at CalArts, I was an intern at the studio, and I worked with Eric that summer. The picture from CalArts, I think, is from our second year. And when I started at the studio, then after my second year at CalArts, I started, just to give you context, the same week, and everyone here is too young to know this too, but the week that Star Wars came out was the year that I started at the Disney studio. So in 77, May 23rd of 77, it came out on May 25th of 77, that Wednesday. So I have a little clip of animation that I'm showing against my better instincts, and particularly with it stretched out. But some people may have seen this. I had a lecture at CalArts a couple of months ago, but... I worked with Eric on some little tests, so this is just, by today's standards, it's horrifying because it's a pencil test, there's no dialogue, we were just supposed to put over an emotion for a character, and this was really based in a way on Farrah Fawcett, God rest her soul, who there was a woman that I had sort of wearing a Farrah Fawcett wig and striking a Farrah Fawcett-like pose, you'll see in here.
I think it's interesting if you know John's caricatures, his drawing style is in this animation. Oh. I never expected that. I always thought he would just draw like a Disney character, but...
Yeah, it looks like... So anyway, if I just hit this, we'll run. Do I have to hit it twice?
It should go.
Yeah. Oh, it's the pathos ending, I know. I guess a wig, thank you. Well, what was sort of typical of that was an assignment we had been given to, because they were looking for people to animate. We started as sort of assistant animators, and I flunked my cleanup test when I first got to the studio. Everybody thought I threw the test. I deliberately did poorly on it. I was like, no, I just can't do cleanup. And so did Brad. Brad Bird and I both flunked our cleanup test because we drew too roughly, so we never got to cleanup. But they asked us to put over an emotion in 10 feet of animation. This was, I think, a Dauntless assignment, actually. See if we could animate on small one or something. And, of course, that's about 30 feet long. So I was not following orders. It was a terrible, but they went along with it. And then so they had me do animation after that. And I did have a caricature. I did, actually, a few years ago. Most of these were done back in the day. But this is Brad Bird. And talking about his, man, we could change all an emerging world, man. I mean, Nancy can attest to this, yes. And for those of
you... That's what he was... That was Brad.
I mean, he's full of that passion. He's still that way, really. He's mellowed to like a fifth of 1%, I think, since then. But, he was very passionate. And Elmer Plummer described it as youthful exuberance. And, of course, this was during Brad's period. There was a guy on TV back then. No one would know him, but Doug Henning. The world of magic. Doug Henning. This was during Brad's Doug Henning period.
He looked like Doug Henning, but his personality was different.
No, different. But then, so the first thing I was working on when I came to Disney was the small one, which was a Christmas featurette, which was directed by Don Bluth. Originally, it was going to be directed by Eric Larson, and then there was a big switch. Don became the director of it. And there were some tensions, I would say, again, between the CalArts people and Don for various reasons. And Don was very busy working, I think, on Banjo, the Woodpile Cat, actually, and his own time, the thing that he really cared passionately about. So he was burning the candle at both ends. So this next picture is a picture of the happy staff on the small one, and so here you are. So that's Jerry Reese in the middle there, who later directed Brave Little Toaster, who went to CalArts with us. That's Brad in the middle, looking like the CEO, and then I'm behind Brad there, and that's Don on the left, John Pomeroy, very talented John Pomeroy, Chuck Harvey, Jeff Vera, all these people, Emily Giuliano, Linda Miller, Bill Haji. Anyway, so it was but this was taken near the end of the small one when people were kind of burned out and fried, and Don wasn't happy with some of the CalArts people for just giving him a hard time about, just everything, pretty much. I mean, just, you know how students are. And so we segued from that, though, into The Fox and the Hound, which Ron was a directing animator on, and that's where I sort of got to know Ron a little bit, although I didn't really work under Ron, but Ron
We knew each other, I think, from the time you started, even when you were there as an intern, I think we sort of met, and we didn't really work together. We both worked on Fox and the Hound, but we didn't actually work together on really any of the same scenes, I think. We didn't really work together until The Black Cauldron, I think we both, because I had wanted, at a certain point, it was like during Fox and the Hound, I really enjoyed animation, and animation is probably the most fun thing you can possibly do, but I was interested in story, and I wanted to get into story, and I pushed very hard to get onto the story of Black Cauldron in terms of that. And I don't know if we go into too much details, but be careful what you wish for.
Yeah,
some degrees,
yeah, Black Cauldron was a slightly tortured experience. And in fact, I was drafted to be a director on the Black Cauldron. They wanted to get some younger voices. At that time, I was younger, and they wanted to get some... younger people.
Me too.
You too. You were even. No, you were older than I was, but you were still younger.
He's about 6 months older than I am.
No, I'm 6 months younger.
See,
That's what I meant.
I just sit here.
This next slide is. It was sort of one of my mentors at the studio that sort of drafted me, Tom Lilhite, who was an executive sort of in live action. And this is a caricature I did of Tom because Tom was the nattiest person I had ever seen in my life. He never had a hair out of place. This was Tom Wilhite in a windstorm, basically. Tom sort of drafted me to be a director on The Black Cauldron. And one of the first things when I got on, I was working with some of these veteran directors who I was trying to sell them sort of my ideas and my approach. And one of the ideas came from the next man, who was John Lasseter. This is John, back in 1981 or something like that, when he was at the studio and he was working on a sequence. They were going to do Mickey and the Nightingale, I think. There was going to be a short like that. And John said, well, if you're working on Black Cauldron, you're trying to get it going, I would highly recommend you use Tim Burton to work on the Black Cauldron. And I knew Tim from CalArts. He was a year behind us at CalArts. And he had started at the studio more recently. And I knew of Tim's work a little bit, but John said, you should really see his sketchbooks, which I hadn't seen. So this is a caricature now that I did of Tim back in the day. This was Tim. This was Tim in his apartment, and this was drawn pretty much accurately. This you could put a photo behind this, and it would almost lay right on top of it because he had mannequins in there, and he had his little black and white TV and everything. And this is, next drawing was actually in this show at the County Museum, if anyone got to see that, or in New York. But this is people in line for the Rocky Horror Picture Show.
This was Tim's drawing.
Tim's drawing, right? Yes. And I love this drawing, and he did a variety of other drawings. So I talked them into letting Tim do ideas on character designs and concepts for the Black Cauldron. And he did a whole bunch of really cool ideas. The Gwythaints, these creatures, I don't have a drawing right here, but he had them, they're like pterodactyl-like things, but in his version, they literally were sort of hands that would grab people as the heads of these birds. And then this next one is what the Horned King was going to look like in his version, which he was actually going to have puppets that talk to each other to give him sort of ideas and whatnot. And also he had the idea that the Horned King, when he got angry, that his horns would actually grow in anger and swirl around his head. It was just a great visual idea. But when Tim suggested these ideas, and I was really supporting them strongly, we brought them to the other directors, and this next drawing represents their response to my great enthusiasm. Don't you want to use Tim? Wouldn't this be the greatest thing ever? And...
So who are these guys?
That is Ted Berman, Art Stevens, and Rick Rich. They were the directors of the Black Cauldron. They were not enthused, and they're all talented folks. And Art did wonderful animation in Ward Kimball's unit and all that back on Mars and Beyond and that sort of stuff. But they just weren't sympathetic to what Tim was doing, so it just didn't happen. So Tim went away, and Tom Woolhite, who was his mentor, gave him an opportunity to do Vincent the Short, and he sort of went off in that direction. And whatever became of that guy anyway?
Yeah.
I do have one more Tim Burton story, and people may have seen this already. I apologize.
People may not realize this, but in those days, Tim was a bit eccentric.
So this next drawing deals with that. On the monitor you can't see it, but that's blood coming out of his mouth. That's not just black. So Tim had his wisdom teeth removed, and then he came to work, and for some reason he took the little stanches that were sort of keeping the blood from pouring out of where his wisdom teeth were removed, and he walked around, if I can walk around like Tim here for a second with that. So he walked to people's desks that he knew. So like Chris Buck, he went to Chris's desk, and I was sort of with Tim when he was doing this, and he would just be there, and he would just drool blood on Chris's desk, and then he would walk to Mike Giamo's desk, and he would just sort of drool blood. And we're like, Tim, I don't know, is this? And he just stood at the end of the. And if you, some of you have been to the animation building, the big window there, just sort of stood there, and just. So he lost enough blood that they were going to take him to St. Joe's across the street. But people think, I'm a caricaturist. I go further than real life, right? So I just happened to find on the internet, isn't the internet great? A few months ago, someone, and maybe this is Harry's Sabin's picture, but this is a picture taken the day Joe Ranft and I were walking around with Tim doing this. So here's a picture of the real event. Okay. I rest my case. Okay, we'll go to the...
Before you move off, Tim, you had the story about this recruiting video. We're always trying to get animators to work at Disney, and so you guys had the same problems back then.
Let's go back to the other one. This is more...
Yeah.
About the time of Fox and the Hound, we actually had college tours where different groups went around to colleges all over the country. John was in one group, I was in another group. And we were recruiting students, and we had this film that we took with us that was... And it wasn't just about animation, it was about live action, it was the whole deal. But there was a segment of this film that had Steve Hewlett, who was a writer at that time and is now, like, he's very involved with the union.
He's head of the union.
Tim Burton, sort of in the middle, and myself, kind of explaining how animation story was done. And Steve started out pretty much talking. He's a very glib guy, talking about story, as it is. I was on the other side. Tim was in the middle, and he was just sort of sitting between us, kind of looking back and forth like, I'm sitting here between two people that I'm very, very frightened of, and I hope that nothing horrible happens. And But there was something, there was a presence, there was a charismatic thing that when people saw this, and we don't have it, we've been trying to find it. That the students, I mean, it was just hilarious. And then finally when it got to Tim, he went into some crazy lunatic thing about how animation story was done that really had no relation to the real thing. But he talked about how we like to dress up as characters when we're working out the story. And we were working on The Fox and the Hound, so he said, like, for instance, like, Steve would dress up as the fox, and then Ron here will dress up as the hound, and then they'll play with each other, like, and it was like, and then he sort of turned it over to me, and I'm like, that's not the way we do it, that's not at all the way we do it. But it was sort of this first impression, though, when this college film was shown, that there was something there that connected with people, any kind of audience. They just, Tim was the only thing that anyone really even noticed. He was just so hilarious.
It's funny.
So this slide, at the same time, John Lasseter was trying to get the Brave Little Toaster going at Disney Tom Wilhite supported the idea and was a proponent of it, to do that film as the first CG feature. So had this happened, this would have predated Toy Story by 10 years probably. In the wake of Tron, John really saw CG as a possible, you know, feature property. So this is a caricature of John Lasseter, Joe Ramft, and Brian McEntee, who were working on Toaster, and we're all excited. And this was them presenting it to the executives. Hey, isn't this great? And, of course, then they said no. And that was their response after that, I'm sorry to say. And so, but how would the world have been different? I don't know if they had said yes, because literally there would have been a CG feature done at least, you know, maybe 10 years before Toy Story ever happened. Would Pixar have happened? Who knows? But it didn't play out that way. But we have a wonderful slide coming up of Ron.
Yes, these are just pictures. I like to play computer chess. this is with Randy Cartwright, who's a friend, a great animator. He did the carpet in Aladdin, and actually Randy and Glenn Keane and John Lasseter, sort of during Fox and the Hound, they came up with a new version of the third act, the bear fight in Fox and the Hound. There was a sort of version before that was, I would say, okay, and they sort of came up with something and really turned that into something very exciting that was kind of one of the first indications of sort of the new group. And Randy's a really talented guy. He was ahead of his time. He's one of the few of our animators who draw who was very much into technology. He was the first guy to get a home computer. He was the first guy pretty much to get every sort of gizmo around. He was the first guy to get on the internet and tell every time, the internet, it's going to be big.
And for you animators, Randy created an app that's a...
first guy to create apps.
He was the first one, no, but he has that turns your iPhone into a stopwatch or something.
Oh, yeah, like animation stopwatch.
Yeah, so that's Randy who did that.
And he's, when you see these videos of the old animation studio, the film.
Yeah, all Randy that stuff in Waking Sleeping Beauty, that home movie footage, that was Randy's film that he shot.
Well, Randy's on screen. And John Lasseter was shooting. And if anybody's seen that, that's kind of fun sort of tour of what the studio was
like.
Yeah,
that was Mark, as Randy was sort of leaving the studio a couple of times to go to work on different projects. We do have Ron and Pete Young here.
Pete Young, really talented story guy. When I moved into story then on Black Cauldron, I worked on Black Cauldron for a while and worked with Pete. And then we shifted off into a Winnie the Pooh feature at the fourth one. You say the third one, the first one was Winnie the Pooh and the Honey Tree. The second was Winnie the Pooh and the Blustery Day. The third one was when I started Winnie the Pooh and Tigger 2. And the fourth one, which at that time was called Winnie the Pooh and Eeyore's Birthday, I actually came up with what I thought was a better title, which was Winnie the Pooh and a Day for Eeyore, which it was certainly better because there was a element in this featurette where Winnie the Pooh played a game called Pooh Sticks. And one of the marketing executives wanted to call the film Pooh Sticks. And we were saying, you cannot call the film...
those for several physicals.
You cannot call this film Walt Disney's Pooh Sticks. It's just not going to work. I think Winnie the Pooh and a Day for Eeyore was a better title. But I was very, very upset at a certain point because Pete and I had kind of developed this story. And it was kind of a cute story, we thought. And then the decision was made to farm it out. It was not animated at Disney. It was animated outside of Disney. And I don't think I would do this in retrospect, but at the time it seemed to me that was somehow like they were sort of presenting it as if it were done at Disney, and I objected to it. And I actually wrote a letter. I sort of regret it now, but I wrote a letter and asked to have my name taken off the film.
And you said that to Ron Miller.
I sent it to Ron Miller, right, who's the head of the studio.
Head of the studio. He's
big, massive guy.
This is a drawing. I did not do. Pete Young did this drawing at the time. This was Ron Miller's response. That's Ron's memo smashed into the wall there on the right side, like with superhuman force. And that's Ron in the foreground. You wanted to see me, Ron. Yeah, this Ron talking to Ron.
Yeah. So my name is not on that film, but. Anyway.
Yes, it's not on the phone. But Ron Miller was the head of the studio then. He had married Walt Disney's daughter. Ron was a good guy, but he wasn't necessarily a film producer so much. He sort of fell into that role. He did have us. He wound up being the producer on The Great Mouse Detective, then called Basil of Baker Street, which I was. The people that were sort of unhappy on Cauldron moved over onto Great Mouse Detective or Basil of Baker Street, and we developed a version. And I was directing that, and I worked for 6 months. Doing that, but my version was somewhat more Monty Python-y back in the day, and it was a kind of a little more extreme.
I worked on it, too.
He worked on it, too, but I was pushing it a little bit more in that direction. Basil, instead of playing a violin, he played a tuba, and it was just stranger all the way around. So we showed it to Ron Miller, and he felt that there wasn't enough...
And Joe Ranft worked on it.
Joe Ranft, did storyboarding on it, and wonderful ideas with Dawson and Basil, and he really... wanted Basil to be sort of manic, the way he is in the books, really, in the novels, in
the Doyle's books.
Yeah. And so when we showed it to Ron Miller, he, after 6 months of work, he really didn't like it at all, and he said kind of start over, and he really felt like there wasn't enough warmth in it. So Joe Ranft did this drawing that I've had hanging up in my room for 30 years since then or whatever, trying to sort of inspire me, and because I love the drawing, but this is a drawing of Ron Miller.
that's very much Joe's style. I mean, if you know
those
Joe,
are my favorite drawings.
Right? Yeah, Joe had this sort of beautiful kind of primitive style, not only drawing but printing. I keep thinking there should be a typeface, the Joe Ranft typeface, because it's sort of this naive kind of childlike printing style. But anyway, so that was Joe's drawing. We did ultimately work on The Great Mouse Detective. Ron actually was the one who came up with the idea to do the film.
Yeah, I was a Sherlock Holmes fan, still am. Had done a film back at a TV station in Iowa about Sherlock Holmes and had seen the books. A book's called Basil of Baker Street, I think, around the time we were doing Rescuers. And we were already doing The Mouse Detective, but I had sort of always thought it'd be fun to do something with Sherlock Holmes and suggested that during The Black Cauldron. And I think because we didn't get, neither John or I really somehow just blended in with the Black Cauldron team exactly. I think we were sort of shifted to this other project.
Yeah, we were banished from the Black Cauldron. Right? Yeah. This is a picture at the time. Me and Vincent Price. So it was great working with Vincent Price, wonderful actor. And one of my favorite memories was going to the commissary, and we had lunch with Vincent Price. And Vincent Price ordered something on the menu, and I just always remember the way he said it. He said, "I'd like to have the gazpacho, please." The gazpacho.
It was also...
So you've heard Vincent Price say gazpacho.
Vincent Price is one of the nicest, warmest, most genuine people, and it would be very tough to get him to sort of lose his temper, but John was able to get him to blow up at one of the recording sessions. If you've seen The Great Mouse Detective, there's a line in the film where Professor Radigan sort of offhandedly says the line, "Felicia, release him," talking about the bat. Vincent Price was doing that line, as we sort of do. John had something in his head. He kept having Vincent Price do that line over and over and over again. Everyone in the room, except John, was aware that Vincent Price was kind of starting to get a little testy.
Right.
But John was totally oblivious to it. He was just trying to get this reading in his head.
Kind of like Basil.
And then finally Vincent Price just kind of blew up.
He kind of exploded. I was just, well, how about this way? How about that way? And he's like, honest to God, I've done it 35 different ways. just tell me one you like, and I'll do it that way. And I said, okay, please save the tape. Stop. And I went out there, and I apologized, and I said, I don't know. I've got this reading in my head, and I don't know what it is. And then he said, I could do it like this. Felicia, release me. Like, that's it, quick. And I ran back and press record. And they pressed it. Okay, and it's like, 494. And then he goes, you know, and Felicia, release him. And he didn't do it the way he did in the rehearsal.
So I'm sure any of you who
have seen... That's it, Vincent, that is it. Yeah. Thank you, thank you.
But I'm sure any of you who have seen the film have probably wondered, why is that line not quite just as good as it could be?
Go back and watch that one. Even myself, now when I say that, what was I thinking?
After this film, did you guys pair up? Were you Ron and John for good?
Well, it was basically...
We got married.
Did you get married?
Yeah, I know. I said this to somebody the other week. I was doing a film festival in Korea. I was like, yes, I've been married to my wife for 31 years, and I've been married to him for 25 years. So.
But yeah, I think we told this, but The Little Mermaid, I actually pitched The Little Mermaid, one of my claim to fame. I'm very proud of that, but there was a thing at the Gong Show where they asked everybody to go out and look for new projects, and I went and I looked for ideas for different projects, and I found a book of fairy tales. I suggested The Little Mermaid at this Gong show. It was originally Gong, but then I had written this two-page treatment, and Mike Leisner and particularly Jeffrey Katzenberg had read the treatment, and they liked it, and I thought there was something there, and the project got into development. And they at that time, we did not write scripts for these movies, which shocks a lot of people. And it was kind of a Disney tradition. I don't know, it was always that way, but on the films I worked on, Rescuers, Fox and the Hound, even The Black Cauldron, there was no really official script. It was sort of just developed with storyboards. But they wanted a script. And I have done some writing. I like writing. I had written one sort of live-action science fiction thing that was done on the very early days of the Disney Channel as a live-action thing. And I'd written some other scripts, and John writes. So I asked him if he wanted to collaborate on a script, and we wrote a treatment, and then... actually, we just... get complicated, but we wrote a treatment to begin with, about a 12-page treatment, and then met with Howard Ashman in New York City and talked about the songs. And
so this is a picture of Howard. A lot of people don't know what Howard looks like, but that's him on the right there. That's Alan in the background on the left, and Pat Carroll in between them, the voice of Ursula. This was when we did actually a reading of the script. Isn't this from the script reading?
This is from the script reading,
which would have been in 1987, I think.
Probably. So John and I wrote a script while Howard was actually directing the musical Smile in New York, and then... And Jeffrey liked the script very much, and then Howard flew out from New York, and it was a great, great collaboration, and Alan Menken was involved, and we did have a story. I know when we wrote the script originally, we've told this before, I don't know, but we had written the part of Ursula, the Sea Witch, with Bea Arthur in mind. That was kind of who we had in our heads, and somehow we could not get the script to Bea Arthur. She had an agent that was just very insulted that we would even consider that Bea Arthur playing a witch, that there was just something insulting about that. So I don't think it ever even got to Bea Arthur. But it worked out fine because Pat Carroll, who's in that picture, then we cast her, and she's still around.
She's amazing.
Yeah.
She did a great
so
job.
So is this the sizzle piece that you kind of toured
around with? Yeah, we were going to show this because we were looking for some things, and I know our time is getting short, but we were looking for some things that we don't think many people have seen because there's things on videos and stuff. This was in the very early stages of The Little Mermaid. We put a sort of demo piece together with a lot of the very early visual development artwork. This was for a Frankfurt Book Fair piece. So this is one of the very first things that was ever... This was before any animation was done, even before a lot of the casting was done. And this is Howard Ashman singing this demo. He's singing the part of Sebastian. This is a demo of Under the Sea put to visuals. And it's a little...
Sorry.
It was almost over. It was almost over.
So some of what you saw in that, those were storyboard drawings by Matt O'Callaghan, who recently did a lot of the Warner Brothers Roadrunner thing in 3D, and he did a Tweety thing in 3D, and Matt did a lot of storyboarding, and then animated Louie on the movie. Also, those boards where she comes up to the ship and all, Tom Enriquez did those things. And then the drawing of the crab that everybody laughed at, that was Ruben Aquino, actually, who did some visual development.
There's Ed Gombert in there, although I think more to come. But
so
there was
Matt
some
Gombert,
Ed Gombert,
and then Roland Wilson, a bunch of drawings by Roland Wilson.
We did those are really realistic paintings.
Actually, the castle, like that was a role.
Well, Chris Van Allsburg did the one with the really sort of a little. Yeah. We had Chris Van Allsburg do some visual development on it. So he did this green. It wasn't on the monitor very well as we saw it here, but it's sort of green and yellow. But that was the basis of the color of that. But that was Chris Van Allsburg. We got to do some pieces. Yeah.
And that's us.
And so, yes, this is us with Jody.
Haven't changed a bit.
Yes, not a bit. right. And this is a caricature I did of the three of us, of Howard and Ron and I. Back in the day, Howard had given up smoking, and so he would chew this plastic straw furiously to sort of overcome his nicotine addiction. So that was sort of Howard's crutch back in the day. And of course, all of you are familiar with the Da Vinci Code, aren't you? And its relationship to the Little Mermaid. So this is part of where that came from, which of course is not at all true. That if you've read
there's
the Da Vinci
a whole
Code.
Whole couple of pages in the Da Vinci Code that somehow went into how the Disney movie The Little Mermaid was part of. I
won't cover
the book. It's all been covered up because of this painting, primarily.
The painting was actually painted by his father-in-law, actually, and then Monica's.
Well, not the original.
Here.
Not the background.
The background. George De La Tour, I think, did the original painting that is in the County Museum, I think, and it was Glenn's idea.
Glenn King wanted to use it, so maybe he's part of the conspiracy. I don't know.
But I have seen Opus Dei mail going to Glenn King's mailbox. I'm not sure, but. But anyway, there was no truth to any of that. But we do want to show a little snip of this. When we were promoting The Little Mermaid, we did get to go down to San Diego, one of the perks, not unlike this.
This was our first publicity tour that we ever took.
Right. So here we are on a kid show in San Diego in 1989. Now watch the kid on the lower right part of your screen. He doesn't seem to care that we're talking. But anyway.
Shotgun Tom Kelly right here on the KUSI Kids Club. And that's right, and there you are too, right here on the Kids Club. And by the way, I want to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving. And we're going to talk to you today about a motion picture that Walt Disney has up called The Little Mermaid. Now, if you haven't seen it, it's playing right now at a theater near you. And the gentlemen on either side of me are the writers and directors of The Little Mermaid. We have over here, we got Ron Clements, and he is one of the writers and directors. The other guy that helped Ron out is a gentleman by the name of John Musker. And welcome to the KUSI Kids Club, John and Ron.
Nice to meet you.
And you know, all of us love to draw. I mean, I bet you kids love to do your favorite drawings. But you know, this picture took over 150,000 different drawings. Now, we call these cells, right?
Right. The first is drawn in pencil, and then we Xerox them onto cells, and they're painted. But basically, 150,000 of these went up into making this movie that's only about an hour and a half long.
Oh, now, Ron, there was a different, like 1,000 different backgrounds, which is kind of the set, right?
Right. We have like the drawings of the characters, which are cells, and they're over backgrounds.
Yeah.
There's about 1,000 backgrounds. I think about 4 years altogether to make this movie.
Wow. See, that's another thing. It takes a long time to put out a motion picture of this magnitude, and we're talking about lots of movement. I mean, just real natural movement. Right?
Yeah. That was cute. And of course, we did segue onto Aladdin. This is Gilbert Gottfried giving me a hard time. Gilbert Gottfried, the voice of Iago here. And what is this guy? And of course, later the voice of the Aflac Penguin, only to insult the entire nation of Japan and get in huge trouble with his comments about the tsunami and whatnot. So Gilbert no longer doing that voice. But we did bring some animation, some early animation that I don't think has been seen too much. But this is Eric Goldberg's first animation of the genie, not actually anything that was used in the film, and actually his first animation on Abu, and I think we have another little piece here, too.
Yeah, there might be. Well, we'll see.
And this was all to sell the idea of Robin
Williams,
right?
This was taken from a comedy album. Robin Williams had recorded a comedy album. This is before we ever met with Robin, but it was always the idea of who might be the voice of the genie. So picked a piece out of the comedy album, and Eric animated a couple tests of that. So,
let's. Oh, yeah.
And it starts out, this is an early, Duncan Marchbanks actually did Abu in the movie, but Eric did an early test. He was the only animator we had at the beginning of Aladdin. But he was a great animator to have. Is that next work? And this was a concept for Iago that changed.
There's no justice.
Yes, originally he was going to have a British accent, yes.
And I think these are the Robin
tests. This is now the Robin tests, yeah.
Wouldn't it be funny though if I was just a hologram and went... Could scare the shit out of a lot of people here. Once again, if there are any little children here tonight, we've used these words in a sentence.
I don't care, it's still stupid.
Now, there's another test coming
up. Before we do the play, I'd like to talk about the very serious subject of schizophrenia. No, he doesn't. Shut up. Let him talk. I'll take that all back.
You can...
We showed that test to Robin Williams to get him to do the movie, and he loved the test, and that really convinced him to do the movie. That was all done before Robin was really involved and just was sort of a selling technique. I think we have a quick... I'm going to try and breeze through quickly, but again, caricatures of people that we worked with at the time. Peter Schneider, who is our... you may have seen him in Waking Sleeping Beauty and whatnot. He produced that, and he was really the guy who ran day-to-day feature animation during the day. Roy Disney with his partner Siegfried and Roy back in the day. Roy was the most unshowy person that could ever run a studio, so this was my reversal of that because he was not at all like a Vegas act. I did this, of course, we worked with Jeffrey, and so I had to throw in something of Jeffrey here. I've done many characters of Jeffrey Katzenberg over the years. This was Jeffrey during the period when they were trying to entice animators. They were getting wooed by other studios, and Jeffrey was really trying to work hard to keep people. So here he is with Andreas, and... You know, and he offered him flowers, and he offered him See's candy, you know, and he offered them money, but that really didn't do anything until finally he offered him milk call drawings. And, oh. Take that, we said. There's a character I did of. Glenn Keane, a few years later, Glenn went off to Paris. He supervised Tarzan while he was in Paris. And I always thought Glenn reminded me of Gene Kelly anyway. So this was Glenn Keane, an American in Paris. And he was sort of doing all that. But the person I've caricatured more than anybody, more than even Jeffrey, is the man to my right, Ron Clements. We have this fun relationship here. So here's one of the drawings I did of Ron a while ago that he denies. Well, there's a story behind it. He denies it. But see, this is Ron here. Now, see, this is what happened, according to my point of view, and I know we're running out of time, but the whole studio, they said from now on, we cannot drink Evian water. It got too expensive or something, so they said, you have to drink Arrowhead water. From now on, everybody's drinking Arrowhead water, and Ron was like, well, I like Evian, you know, so they made an exception for him, so only he got to drink Evian, everyone else drank Arrowhead. So I did this drawing, and if you'll notice, there is... On his little cape there, Ron has a bunch of basset hounds. So I have little basset hounds woven into the cape.
Four basset hounds.
Yeah, four basset hounds. So anyway, this was Ron and his Louis the 14th. Now, Ron also, he has a habit of when we meet the various celebrities, they all think he's a stalker. And so this was, we go to these Academy Award luncheons. We met Diane Lane there sitting at our table. And here was Sandra Bullock. We conversed with her. This was Ron when he met up with Michael Moore, the famous Michael Moore. And he was complimenting, actually, really, that my caption isn't really what he was saying, but he was complimenting him on the average, whatever this book, Average White Guy, whatever it was, some book that he was really complimenting on, but he just, you know, thought Ron was a stalker, sort of, and he just wanted to get away. He wanted to get away as quickly as possible. But during the making of Treasure Planet, particularly, I just found these the other day. I forgot I had these. I have half a dozen of these drawings that Angela Lupita, who I worked with then, had saved these. She was going to put them in a scrapbook because I was always doing these little doodles.
I haven't
of Ron.
Seen these because
some of these
been
he hasn't seen in a while. They're just ridiculous things. This next one is Ron in the buffet line. Whenever he went through a buffet line, this was the invariable result. He would just drop food. Ron, of course, was the bulldog of story, and he would get into huge heated arguments with other people if they wanted to adjust the story, but this was his thing. I am not tenacious. But, And then he got excited about this, where he said, yes, we need a fun meeting where we decide who will die. And then there was, we needed to work on the ticking clock of Treasure Planet. He was recalling one of his favorites, the Andromeda Strain. I, for one, particularly admire its ticking clock. And in his true sci-fi geek mode. And speaking of that, Ron is a Trekkie. He will deny it, but I swear, he not only has a Star Trek pinball machine in his playroom, he has both a Captain Picard uniform and a Captain Kirk uniform that he dresses in. So this is a drawing at the time. That's it. Turnbuckle is Sulu. Yeah. He was realizing that each one of our characters was somehow analogous to a Star Trek character, I think. And just the other day, he did the same thing on the movie we're working on now. It's like unbelievable. But it's some people it's Star Wars. Some people it's whatever.
Are you okay with all this, Ron?
Oh, fine.
Of course, we teased him about because he's got a long torso and short legs.
Which
so
is
we
kind
had
of like
this,
a basset hound,
not actually. Dwarfish. And he's always talking about his dogs. Let me tell you about my dog's phobia about skateboarders. I don't know what had to do. And he had dog, and his dogs occasionally would get surgery, so in order to sort of commune with the dogs and make them feel at home, he would also wear the cone. And this next one, I didn't draw. I don't know who drew this, but who drew this? What's the story here? Ron's recurring high school dream. Is that Mike Cho drew that, maybe? Mike Cho?
I don't know.
Okay. Can you elaborate
it's
on this
true,
one?
It's true, though, but I'm not going to elaborate on it.
And so we had a quote wall where we would keep a few quotes of what things people would say during the course of these meetings.
Time is running short.
But we'll go through these very quickly. Here's there's definitely things we could do to make X1 and 2 shorter if we weren't adding things. That's one thing. This is a bad idea, and it won't be the first one. Like that. And then this next one. Have you ever been inside the house of someone who's crazy? To which I responded, well, I've been to your house. there's next one. Ron, we were having an argument. He said, I'm saying the same thing you're saying. And I said, well, then stop saying it. It just was our natural bicker.
This is like a roast.
And then finally, I know, we're almost done with this section. But I did really say this, yes. He treats the dogs better than me. I'm sorry.
It's true.
It is true. No, but we have a good relationship. We bicker. We're like a married couple. They say, actually, I don't bicker with my wife. I bicker with him. I take out all the bickering.
We argue from time to time.
Not really.
That's part of the process.
I wouldn't call it arguing. But no, we do. So we have a few clips quickly. We're going to just try and get as many clips.
Before they kick us out, we'll
okay,
watch
did the light flash? Okay, here's a clip of live action reference from Hercules. We shoot this live action reference of dancers. It's intercut. We have a little bit of this. We have Ken Duncan's animation to start off. It's great. You'll see how cheesy this live action is if you haven't seen it before. It actually is helpful in terms of choreography and some praise.
We've shot live action on Mermaid, Aladdin. Hercules and Princess of the Frog. Treasure Planet was the only one we actually didn't shoot live action.
And
some of its choreography.
And sometimes the dancers, had to leave early in that, so we would press other people into service. So you see people staying in the background who are.
And the song
production
here is.
And the song is, I won't say, and it's slightly different.
A little different
in the
beginning than what's in the movie.
Yeah, which we didn't. I don't really even remember the story on that, but the very first lyrics of this, if you're familiar with the movie, are not the lyrics that are in the actual finished.
So this one's about a minute, so here we go. Let's run this.
You'd think a girl would learn. My heart is racing like a stallion. My head is telling me, whoa there. My heart is saying you can trust him. My head is warning me, girl, don't go there. My heart keeps saying that he's different. And he's the very first one that a girl like me can really count on. My head keeps whispering, been there, done that.
Who you think you're kidding? He's the earth and heaven to you. Try to keep it hidden. Honey, we can see right through you. Girl, you can't conceal it. We know how you're feeling. Who you thinking of?
Oh, no chance, no way, I won't say.
Swoon, you sigh, why deny it? Uh-oh,
it's
unless you're dying to cry your heart out.
It actually was helpful, and I say cheesy. Our production guys were cheesy, but the actors were good actors. Michelle Beauchamp in there, and Bobby Gant, and the choreographer, we actually did En Vogue videos, Frank Yatson. But that gave us sort of a jumping off point. Ken Duncan would be there and kind of supervising the stuff and really using it as his first rough pass. Quickly, we want to show you a bit of animation. We wanted Hades to be the voice of Jack Nicholson originally in Hercules. And this is a piece of animation that no one almost has ever seen. Did this animation. We were trying to sell Jack Nicholson on the idea of
being Hades. We met with Jack. It's a long story. I don't think we have time. But we showed him this. We showed him this.
And I hope the audio works. If it doesn't,
please hold the cord. Let's hope it works.
Take caution in your tone, Commander. I'm a fair guy, but this f***ing heat is making me absolutely crazy.
Great animation.
Didn't make it. I mean, Jack was really great to meet. He was actually really nice.
That was a line from A Few Good Men, by the way.
And then he was interested in doing it. They just were not able to work out a deal. But it worked out fine because James Woods was
it was a crazy,
fantastic,
entertaining day with Jack coming in because we showed him the animation. He loved the animation, and he sort of wanted to do the part. He brought in his kids, who were little at that time, Lorraine and Raymond. He's like, look at the pictures, man, you know. But it was kind of funny that because it was right around Christmas and his daughter was dressed as Snow White and we had a bunch of plush dolls to give him to sort of win him over and everything. He talked to us about how he used to work at, he was one of the last guys to work at Hanna-Barbera before they shut it down, when it did shorts, at the MGM Shorts. But anyway, he walked out with a bag of swag and it was one of my favorite memories of the period because he had his dark glass on, it was kind of windy outside and his hair was sort of blowing up and he just said, Merry Christmas. and Vincent Price with the gazpacho, I'm telling you. So this next little bit, we're in the Hercules section, but it's a rap video. When we wrap the movie, there's a lot of people in this.
This, I think, has not been seen.
It's not a rap video. It's a rap party video.
Yeah, not rap.
this was seen. Yes, it's not at all. This was seen when
this
the movie
is Eminem. You don't
at the rap
Eminem
party.
Was
this was made specifically for the Hercules rap party. So the whole staff at the rap party saw this. Other than that, no one has ever seen this, and that's mainly the reason we're showing it. Is it's something that no one has ever seen.
It's a little slice of life back from 1997. So here we go.
I haven't seen this one before.
Which one is this?
Is this the one with Arnold?
Tom Arnold, maybe.
My boy, I've discovered something very important.
Your hands are cold.
Up to now, I've been making one big mistake. You should sleep in the daytime and stay awake at night.
I learned this from Tony Fucilli.
The sun out there dulls the senses.
Much like the Black Cauldron.
Enough. I'm hungry.
Quickly, girls, back to color models.
What a life. You wake up in the morning without a care in the world and nothing to do.
Sounds like Michael Ovitz.
Hey, this would make a great animated movie.
Hercules?
Hercules? I think it's a good idea.
Hercules?
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 Did you say Hercules?
Hercules.
They speak only of Hercules.
What does he have to do with me?
What was that name again?
Hercules.
Hercules!
I want to be like you, Hercules.
You know how much I love you, Hercules.
Why is it you keep on calling me Hercules?
Hercules!
Hercules.
Hercules.
Yes.
And the nicest guy.
Oh, Hercules, Hercules, Hercules.
I must destroy these upstarts who make mockery of the great name of Hercules.
Hercules?
Hercules!
You do not mess with Hercules.
Hercules?
What?
Hercules!
Hercules.
We know!
I got it. I got the concept.
So listen! We got a movie that's coming out, don't we? It's coming out in June. It's now. It's here. It's opening day. It's spring season. It's all that. The World Series wrapped into one. Is it not?
Yeah!
Some of you guys have been slacking off a little bit. You've been dogging it. I don't want to name any names, but some of you trot out to the outfield on the 40-yard line. You're barely kneeling. You're lifting yourselves up. Do we want any of that?
No!
DreamWorks is waiting for all you guys to fail. What are you going to do about it? Okay, you guys, now you got to get out there.
We can skip the Rapunzel stuff. Let's skip it. Thank you. All right. So, should we skip that too? Should we go to questions?
Sure.
I mean, we are pretty much out of time, but we can take some questions for a couple minutes.
This is a little caricature I did of Roy Disney and Michael Eisner on Family Feud when they were not getting along too well. But anyway, let's do some. Let's open this up to a few minutes of questions here. I'm not in that image though.
There's a hand right there.
What are you working on, man?
we
can't really talk about it. We are in development on a project, still in fairly early stages, that we're excited about, but we can't really talk about it.
Yeah.
Should I ask my question?
Yeah, go ahead. What's your question?
I knew people would ask this, and then they would want to know, is it 2D or is it CG?
To which the answer is
yes.
Yes. Any other questions? We have 5 minutes. I don't know, there are mics out there maybe, but you can just yell. I see a hand there.
Third row, yeah.
What's been your biggest disagreement on a film?
I don't remember between the two of us. The biggest one I remember, and it's still sort of funny, but it goes back to The Great Mouse Detective, which all the while we worked on that film, we worked on it as Basil of Baker Street, and that was the title of the movie that we sort of thought of. And at the last minute, Jeffrey Katzenberg, because the movie Young Sherlock Holmes didn't do so well, Jeffrey kind of forced us to change the title to The Great Mouse Detective, which was a title we did not like. And I feel like that's, weirdly enough, almost the biggest argument. But that was us really arguing with Jeffrey
with each
more.
Other. The smaller issues, the little things, maybe a scene here or there, but nothing
don't
too
think
major,
we've ever gotten into.
He did throw a bottle of water at a wall once at something where I said where he really got mad, and he just threw this bottle of water at the wall.
I honestly don't think we.
Yeah.
But I generally, our process is that we do argue a lot, and usually the one that feels stronger wins the argument. Sometimes if we are not in agreement, like working on Princess the Frog, then John Lasseter or whoever might be, they might sort of be the arbiter. But I don't remember anything offhand that was really sort of a major thing. Generally, we write the first drafts of the scripts of all our movies together, and we work things out quite a bit at that point. So after that, it's always seemed like we're seeing the same movie. And the arguments are more really about how to do certain things. What's the better way to
I'd say in the detail
something.
Sometimes we get in arguments.
And don't
about
you split up the sequences? You take some and you take some.
Yeah, we came up in a system where there were sequence directors who did different, the classic Disney films that had multiple directors on them. And so we kind of came up in that system. So we divide the movie up into sequences, and I do some and he does some. And But we come together for a lot of things, for the voice recording and for the sweatboxing, which is sort of the critiquing of all the work. So, yeah, it's a very collaborative process. Any other questions?
There's one hand way back there.
I mean, I would have to say Robin Williams
was... Mark Walton asked that question?
Mark, you're my favorite voice actor.
Did you know, ladies and gentlemen, that was asked by the voice of Rhino from Bolt. Stand up, Mark Walton. If we had worked with you, Mark, it would have been you, but you never did a voice for us.
I mean,
you did Scratch for us.
Generally, I think we've gotten along pretty well with all the voice actors that we work with, even Vincent Price, in spite of that one thing. But Robin, there was kind of something sort of special going on, I think, with that. He and there again, that's the only time we've ever worked with him, but he was so into it, and I mean, the part of the genie was written in script form, kind of as, it was written for Robin, so it was kind of the stuff that he did, but certainly he was encouraged to ad-lib, which he did, and he would come in for 4-hour sessions, and he would almost go nonstop for 4 hours, and it was him. It wasn't us pushing him. It was him pushing himself, because he would kind of do the scenes over and over and over again, and we'd think, we've got so much good stuff, and he'd want to do it again and again and again, and it was almost hard to stop. And he would keep, every time he did it, it was different. So that was kind of an amazing experience.
Let me show you that other clip. Let's see if I can get to it. We have a clip of a voice test here that... was done to... this was done to Johnny Depp's voice. We were considering him doing the Prince on Princess and the Frog. So this is a line from... it works a lot better when you can hear his voice.
I give women pleasure. No, I never take advantage of a woman. I give women pleasure.
So that was a line from Don Juan DeMarco. Randy Haycock animated that. We were considering using Johnny Depp. And then it sort of didn't work out. We wound up with Bruno Campos, who we really loved, who was of Brazilian descent. But sometimes that happens where we, like we did with Jack, we do a line and it doesn't work out. But I'd say generally the voice actors we've worked with across the board, they so much of your work is done when you cast a good actor, because they're so adaptable and amenable and bring so much to the party.
Certainly we cast every voice pretty carefully. I think our background is animators. We were both animators, so I think we have a sense somewhat of how much the voice can give you if you have a good voice to work with, and kind of how difficult it can be if somehow the voice isn't giving you what you need to put across.
And just putting an actor's voice, even if they haven't come in, or if they have come in, and just putting it against still storyboard drawings really can tell you a lot as far as if the voice is working or not. And you pair it up with the other... I know my mic is cutting in and out.
Your voice isn't working.
So anyway, okay, other questions?
How much time do we have?
We're going to finish early. We have another test.
Looks like we can keep going. There's questions back there.
You said at the beginning, you started at a time when future animation was very much in doubt.
Right.
Obviously, you reached a point beyond wildest expectations. Was there a moment along the way when you looked at each other and it kind of dawned on you that this is bigger than we ever could have thought?
That's a good question. I do remember just to this period, like we say, we 1970 when Star Wars came out. Star Wars came out 1977. I mean, there was this sense of wow. I mean, that was the biggest movie that had ever been made, and there was a question: can an animated film ever sort of? Could there be a Star Wars in animation? I think that was. That was always a discussion among a lot of...
Well, there was even a question that I know you had a bet with someone who's doing a panel right now, I think, right? That could an animated film even ever break $100 million?
There were questions like that, you know, it just how... And I always felt that it could. I mean, that there could be the equivalent of like a Star Wars animation. Of course, Snow White was that in its own time, but that was so many years earlier. And some people didn't. I think my feeling, I remember saying at the time, because there was a certain point where wrestling on TV became just huge. And I was saying, if wrestling can become that big, animation could become that big. But
you set the bar high.
Do you think that state of mind shifted the way you approached making your movies? Like, to not make them like they used to be? Or
It's hard to tell. I mean, The Little Mermaid, certainly I think when I started, I was like in my 20s. We were not married. We didn't have families. And it was kind of upsetting that people that were our age never went to see the movies that we worked on. The movies pretty much were for families and kids. So we were part of the age group that almost didn't go to the movies that we made. And yet we made the movies for ourselves. I mean, that's always kind of what you do. And we've never really thought of the films as being films aimed at kids. We always know that the films have a lot of appeal to kids, but we wanted them to aim really pretty much for everybody. I think that was one of the most satisfying things on The Little Mermaid, that it broke through to a much wider audience than the audience that traditionally went to Disney films. And that was, I think, surprised us to a certain extent, but it was also a goal to a certain extent, because we felt like, I mean, we're Disney fans, we both grew up, and we felt all the Disney films that Walt Disney was involved with, they're not kids' films, they're adult films, and they totally work for adults if adults watch them. And it was just, I think, satisfying to see that breakthrough and to see that the stigma.
I remember going in 1986, I saw American Tail at the Eagle Rock Plaza, and I went on opening night, Friday night at 8 o'clock, and it was sold out. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't get in, you know, and I was like, wait, this is American Tail, and I can't get in? So I think American Tail sort of started to kind of broaden the audience, and then Roger Rabbit came out sort of after that and kind of widened the audience, and then Mermaid sort of broadened the audience after that. I think one of the other sort of revelation moments for us was when we had our first preview of Little Mermaid, the AMC Burbank, right down the road here, and just seeing what a strong response it got from such a general audience and a date audience and whatever else. Jeffrey Katzenberg couldn't believe it because it scored such high numbers across the board. And again, we work on these movies in the dark for a few years and we don't know how they're going to play. Really, strangers have not seen them, and it's only the staff who works on it that's seen it. So that suddenly people that, you know, had no vested interest in liking it really, really liked it a lot. And that, I remember Jeffrey was just practically in a daze walking out of that thinking, how do I market this movie? Because this isn't just for kids. This is a movie that can appeal to a general audience. So at that point, he kind of shifted his own marketing campaign. They started doing kind of the adult campaign and the kids campaign. But it was fun to see it start to reach into the pop culture mainstream the way those other films we had admired
and then,
did.
And then like Beauty and the Beast, which we didn't work on, kind of took it further. And then Aladdin actually sort of went in terms of just Aladdin really was a film. No one really thought of that almost.
But
as
then
a kids,
Lion
as
King after
movie.
That.
Then Lion King was the pinnacle of
yeah.
That.
And now, obviously, you know, there's many successful films, you know. And this year, I saw just the other day, and it's the international box office statistics. In the top 10 films alone of the year around the world, three of them were animated films. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, to see a day like that back in the dark days of 19. Yes, let's hear it for animation.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it is true. In the 1970s, that would have been hard to imagine.
Yeah, it was impossible. Yeah,
well, I mean, I think you guys absolutely paved the way for all of us having jobs today. So thank you. And I think we're going to have to wrap this up. I think we're short on time. We're good? That means yes?
That means good.
That's it.
Okay, thank you, everyone.
Okay, thanks, everybody.